you join with me in giving a welcome to Dr. Matthew John, please. Thank you.
I am going to start by reading from the scripture. Actually, I'm going to read from two scriptures. One is a Christian scripture, which we call the Bible, and then a Hindu scripture, which is actually, there are so many different scriptures in Hinduism, but one of the most famous or the ancient one is called Rig Veda. So I'm going to read from the Bible first, then I'm going to read from Rig Veda. Acts chapter 17, verses 23. So this is an episode where Paul and his companions, they are waiting for somebody else in a city called Athens, and he happens to find an idol which is marked to the unknown God. That's what it says. So this is what Paul says in the scripture. Acts chapter 17, verse 23. For while I was passing through and examining the objects of your worship, I also found an altar with this inscription, to an unknown God. Therefore, what you worship in ignorance, this I proclaim to you. Okay? Now, if you were interested, you can go home and read the rest of it. Basically, Paul is saying that what you are worshiping by saying to the unknown God, you know, that's the name of the idol, is actually a pointer to the God I am going to speak to you, who is Jesus Christ. Interesting. Now, Rig Veda, the ancient Hindu scripture, if you read Rig Veda, very difficult to read, but it is available free in the internet, sacredtext.com, if you are interested. And if you go to Rig Veda Mandala 10, Mandala is a word of saying, it's a way of saying chapter, Mandala 10, Hymn 121, which is the song 121, guess what Mandala 10, Hymn 121 of Rig Veda is titled? The title, you can Google it, not now, you can Google it at home. And Mandala 10, Hymn 121 of the Hindu scripture Rig Veda is titled, To the Unknown God. I'm not making it up, it's there. To the Unknown God. So these are some of the verses from that To the Unknown God scripture of Hinduism. In the beginning, there arose the golden child. As soon as born, he alone was the Lord of all that is. He established the earth and this heaven. Who is the God to whom we shall offer sacrifice? He who gives breath, he who gives strength, whose command all the bright gods revere, whose shadow is immortality, whose shadow is death, who is the God to whom we shall offer sacrifice? He who through his might became the sole king of the breathing and twinkling world, who governs all this, man and the beast, who is the God to whom we shall offer sacrifice? The beauty of this poem is that it shows us the unquenchable thirst for truth in a religion. Hinduism is all about a question. It is not about answers. The Hindus are not particular about Westerners and all religions, I mean, which is kind of based on that worldview, is obsessed with answer, apologetics, give us the answer. Hinduism is an expert in raising questions. They are in a search for truth. And it continues through millennia. Actually, Hinduism is the oldest religion in the world. So this question, which you just read from To the Unknown God of Rig Veda, they still ask the question, who is the God to whom we shall offer sacrifice? Anyway, so as you just heard today, Hinduism is for sure, is the most complicated religion in the world. So if you get a grasp of Hinduism, which I'm sure you will not, it's a very bad disclaimer to make in the beginning, but if you get at least a glimpse of what it is, you must be very good, because you can, all other religions, you because when you study world religions, there are basically six major living religions. There are so many religions, but out of these six major living religions, three of them come from India, or the Eastern religions, Hinduism, Buddhism, and Sikhism. Okay? Then the other three are not from the West, because there are no Eastern religion and Western religion. West doesn't have any religion. It's actually come from the Middle East, so we normally call it Abrahamic religions, right? Because all these three religions, which is Judaism, Christianity, and Islam, they all trace their roots back to one man. His name is Abraham. So we call it Abrahamic religion. So Judaism is the mother of all the Abrahamic religion. Right? You need to study Judaism to get a better understanding of Christianity, to get a better understanding of Islam. In the same way, if you go to the Eastern side, the other three, Hinduism is the mother of all the other Eastern religions, the three religions. So Hinduism and then Buddhism is basically nothing but a revised version, or some would call a heretic version of Hinduism. That's why Buddhism is one of the fast-growing religions in the Western world, that's what they say, but it has nearly become obsolete in India, where it came from. You know, Buddha was an Indian guy like me, right? But I lived in India for around 30 years, I never seen a Buddhist. The first Buddhist I saw was in Canada, and I'm sure there are Buddhists in India, but all I'm saying is it's a dying religion in India, because there is nothing that Buddhism can offer which Hinduism has not already given. Does that make sense? Okay. And then Sikhism is actually a hybrid religion between Islam and Hinduism. I don't want to go in there. But basically, what Sikhism did was, it borrowed the concept of God from Islam, because Sikhs believe in one God. Like, they are monotheistic. So they believe in one God, but their worldview comes from Hinduism. Like they believe in reincarnation and all the other things. So Sikhism is like mother is Hinduism and dad, father is Islam. So you have to study history anyway. That's not the point here. So Dr. Varsan Abraham said today, Hinduism is, if you go to YouTube and search for Hinduism lectures, there are not so many compared to Islam or any other religion, because it's not that easy to do a lecture on Hinduism. And whatever you find, maybe five or six, I guess, after 5 minutes, 10 minutes, you will click that stop button. Because it's going to be so boring, it's going to be so philosophical. It's philosophical is okay, but it's more, the word is esoteric. You know what that means? It's kind of a mix of philosophy and mysticism, and you won't understand what they are trying to say. Even the person who is saying has no clue what they are saying. It's very clear from the video itself. And most of this video, it's funny thing, you can check, they disable the comments in the YouTube, because people get crazy when they watch it. So most of the videos I Google for Hinduism just to see what other people. So they all disable the comments, because people get mad when they hear this kind of stuff. Anyway, so my main objective today is not to make you mad. Dr. Watson said again, it is very important to understand the relevance of Hinduism, because Hinduism is not just some a creedal religion like Christianity or Islam or Judaism. Hinduism is essentially a worldview. So you can be a Christian and a Hindu at the same time. Hindus don't have a problem. Hindus have a problem when you sing that song which Natasha sang today. She sang, we sang with her, in Christ alone. That's where they have a problem. If you say Christ is my cornerstone, good, go for it, Natasha. That's what I will say. But the moment you say in Christ alone, that takes to another level. Anyway, this is an article from Newsweek magazine, which basically says that we are all Hindus now. It comes after a poll research. This is a Western magazine done by a Westerner, and recent polls show that our worldview, American worldview, you're talking about American worldview, is shaped after Hinduism. Everybody knows yoga, right? You haven't heard about yoga, right? How many of you had heard about Lectio Divina? It's shame on us that we haven't heard Lectio Divina. I mean, it's a Christian meditation technique, in a way. I mean, I don't want to call it technique, but it's a Christian meditation discipline, a practice, which Catholics do, and we don't get into all this. So we go to yoga, right? So so Lectio Divina is, so what I'm trying to say is, many things, you know, yoga, reincarnation, I was teaching in a Sunday school back in the days in a Presbyterian church. You know, most of them high schoolers, like, you know, college age young kids. And it was a Christmas kind of a sermon, and they were asking me to talk about Jesus being born. Then I was talking about Christmas is the day God incarnated, the incarnation of God. And I kept saying this, and these kids, they are not kids, high schoolers, right? All, you know, Scottish, Irish, you know, the Presbyterian, like, white people, wonderful people, I am assuming that they have great understanding of Christianity and background. And after a while they say, oh, excuse me, sure. So what is the word you said? Which word? Incarnation? I said, oh, you don't know what incarnation is? So I said, yeah. No. So I said, incarnation means like God comes in flesh. God comes as a human being. So then this kid saying, oh, you mean avatar, right? You mean avatar? Yeah, and I said, yeah, that's right. That's what it means. Avatar is the Hindu word or Indian word or Sanskrit word, which comes from the theological vocabulary of Hinduism, which is very, very popular in the Western world. And this nice Presbyterian Christian kids didn't know incarnation, which comes from the Christian vocabulary, whereas they knew very well. So I had to switch my gear and talk from a Hindu perspective to these kids. You know, not kids again. Sorry, the young folks. So you can see the influence of Hinduism in our worldview, and we don't take it. When we did a seminar on Islam, a lot of people were very interested because Islam is like right in front of you, right? Like, you know, because you can see it and very confrontational. But the thing about Hinduism is very subtle. It's very subtle. I think Watson-Engel used the word creeps in, right? It's very subtle and creep into the churches and in our worldview system. I'm not saying it's a bad thing. I'm a big respect. If you ask me to pick which is your favorite religion outside Christianity, I don't think of Christianity as a religion. It's a personal experience to me. So Hinduism is a religion I respect the most. So I have nothing against it, but you have to understand the relevance of it. And that's what they are saying. If you read the article, she is quoting from Stephen Prothero, who's the religion professor at Boston University. I mean, so it's not just somebody made up. This is an authentic scientific research article quoting experts in the field. Anyway, and as I said, Julia Roberts, a very famous Hollywood actress, is a Hindu. She went to India to shoot that movie. I don't know how many of you say Eat, Pray, Love, right? Yeah. So she had this moment of enlightenment or what have you. She became a Hindu. And then Beatles, you know, they shaped our culture, Western world, as they were Hindus. As you can see, Maharshi Mahesh Yogi was appointed as the spiritual director. I showed, you know, he is the CEO of Microsoft right now, Satya Nadella. And this is Sundar Pichai, the CEO of Google. Man, Microsoft and Google, the CEOs, are Hindus. Wonderful thing. Good for them. I'm showing this to understand the relevance of Hinduism in our culture. Don't think about, oh, Hinduism is something somewhere in the other side of the globe, you know, some Indian guys, you know, nice little Indian guys doing some kind of exotic religious practice. No, that's not what it is. It is very, very relevant today here in our society. And Steve Jobs, and not so many people know that Steve Jobs directly attribute all his enlightenment experience he had when we went to India. That actually turned his career around. He doesn't call himself a Hindu or something, but he had a New Age spirituality outlook. as you probably know, and some critics even complained that he didn't receive proper treatment for his cancer. It could have been cured, but he said, I want this holistic treatment, which is all coming from the New Age philosophy. Anyway, I don't know how many of you knew this. This is a picture of Empire State Building. The Lord Kali, which is the Hindu goddess, was projected there, I think 2015 summer or something like that. Lord Kali's image was projected in Empire State Building right here. Avatar, as you know, the largest blockbuster ever, you know, the money to make, you know, the movie to make the largest sum of money to this day, $3 billion, right? Where does the word come from? James Cameron could have, he's a Canadian, by the way, he could have picked any name for his movie, but he was smart. He didn't choose incarnation like me. He knew that he won't be able to communicate to the culture. He's selling this movie too. So he picked Avatar. Movie got grossed $3.3 billion. So, unfortunately, in the Western world, even today, many of us think that Hindus are, you know, most of the people's perception of Hinduism comes from this little guy. I don't know how many of you have seen him. His name is Appu, right? Appu from Simpsons. You know, he always say, thank you, come again, right? My Indian accent is very bad because I already have an Indian accent, so I'll try it. People think, yeah, this is what they think. Oh, you know, and he has this god Ganesha, you know, with all gods with the elephant head, and people think religion, Hinduism is some kind of cute, little exotic thing framed after Appu. But my point is, no, it is much bigger than you could perceive. And here is, I don't know how many of you know her. It's funny, whenever they show Indians, they always have this Namaste, right? Like that's the Indian thing. And she is Tulsi. In Indian language we call her Tulsi, but in Westerners call her Tulsi Gabbard, the first Hindu to be elected to US Congress. Right? You probably know her. She's from Hawaii. And wonderful lady. She, if I'm right, she's an army veteran or something like that. But people have very bad perception, and her, I don't know if I have a quote by her opponent for this election, saying something very mean about her and accusing not just her, but Hindus in particular. So her opponent, this is what she said, oh, she is a Hindu, Tulsi is a Hindu, they worship the devil. And then she is a devil Democrat, say, and then this opponent, who's a Republican candidate, I think, she says, oh, as Christians, we would say a vote for Tulsi Gabbard is a vote for Satan, the devil. Do you agree? That's so mean. That's so mean. And to bring Christianity into this, right, to say that, oh, that's what Christians should think of. Basically, what she's saying is that Christians should think of Hindus as some kind of crazy folks worshipping demons and devils. That's not what it is. And that's very mean for people to say this. So that's why we need some seminars or seminars like this. That's kind of the purpose and the reason behind, you know, what we are doing. Again, it is we are learning Hinduism from a Christian perspective. I have given this introduction at the time of Islam seminar. Every religion can be studied from different perspectives. If you ask a Hindu to come and present it, he might have a very different way of saying it. And if you ask an atheist or a philosopher or an academic to come here and say, he might have a different way of saying it. The good thing about me, I'm not promoting myself, because I'm coming from India, I lived there for 30 years, and some of my best friends are Hindus, and they are actually wonderful people. Hindus are probably some of the most friendly, wonderful people you can meet in planet Earth. So they, you know, so I have a Hindu understanding of this religion, and also, as you heard, I'm an academic, and you know, I got my PhD from one of the reputed institutions in the world. So I have studied Hinduism from an academic perspective. But mostly, I want to talk to you about Hinduism from a human perspective. See, there's one thing to talk about academic things. It's one thing to talk about philosophy and all that kind of stuff. But I want us to understand Hinduism, or Hindus as human beings, right? So Hindus as human beings, they don't believe in all this philosophy and all this kind of big lectures about what part of what I'm going to make, which is important. But Hindus, essentially, who are they? They are just people like us. And how can we relate to them? And it's not something something like an option. It is our obligation to learn and understand and to relate to them as human beings first. Rest is, you know, the other part. Anyway, so fun facts about Hinduism. You already heard this from Dr. Wilson Abraham. Hinduism is the only living religion without a founder. All other religions can be attributed to some people, like, you know, Abraham or Jesus or Muhammad or Buddha or Guru Nanak. Or all these religions have some kind of founders. Hinduism do not have it does not have a founder. But Hinduism, that's even more interesting. Hinduism was invented by non-Hindus. Isn't that interesting? Nobody really created Hindu. That's why Hinduism is not a creedal religion. It doesn't have a universal set of codes and principles. So if you want to go to, if you want to become a Hindu, just imagine you want to become a Hindu, okay? There is no way you can do it in the sense, there is no way you can, there is nobody, you cannot go to the Pope, or you cannot go to Billy Graham, the evangelical Pope, our Pope, and ask them to convert, because there is no conversion formula. There is no creed you can read and become a Hindu. If you just want to be a Hindu, just say that you are a Hindu, that's all. It's just as simple as that. That's why everybody say I'm a Hindu. Julia Roberts say I'm a Hindu. But I don't want to disrespect her or anybody. Most of these people have no clue about what Hinduism is, right? Hinduism is not a religion. It's an amalgamation of many different religions. I'll explain it when I talk about the history of Hinduism. Okay, so this is where it all began. This is India back in the days, years ago, okay? Now, 1920s, I don't know how many of you follow archaeology. 1920s, there was some, what do you call it, dig up, right? The archaeologists dig up stuff, right? So they found these two places called Mohenjo-Daro and Harappa. There they discovered that there are this ancient civilization which date back to 2500 up to 3000 BC. There were this ancient civilization. They had their own cities, they had their own language, and they were very civilized people existed in that area. So they did a lot of research, and they came up with some of these ideas, and they traced the origin of Hinduism. Now, this civilization is based around a river called Sindh, S-I-N-D-H. There's a river in that part of the world, you probably can see that line, right? So that's called the Sindh. So they called it Sindh River Civilization. So there was this group of people who existed long, long time ago, had their own civilization. Now, 500 BC, somewhere around, I'm just giving you an approximate figure because it's not extremely important for you, just to frame your mind. Somewhere around 500 BC, that's 500 years before Jesus was born, the Persian kings, you remember the book of Esther in the Bible? And the book of Esther starts by naming a king who was also the ruler of India. So that's how the name India is in the Bible. I don't know how many of you knew that. Yeah, so a Persian king was the ruler of this kingdom, which extended up to India. So the Persians at that time came to India, and they basically came and they captured the whole place. They ruled that territory, and they called people on the east side of the Sindh River as Hindus, because Persians didn't know how to pronounce Sindh, so they called it Hind. Okay? Because Sindh is a Sanskrit word and Hind is a Persian word. So everybody east of this, that means all this area, everybody, all these people who lived east of that river, they called Hind, Hindus. So that's how the name first came, approximately 500 years before Jesus Christ. So which means, if you have your ethnic root anywhere here, you are a Hindu. You can't change it, right? I mean, you can be a Christian, you can be a Muslim, you can believe in whatever you want, but essentially, according to the original definition of the word, you are a Hindu. And if you are not from that part of the world, I don't care whether you're Julia Roberts. I don't care if you're Steve Jobs. You cannot be a Hindu. I'm sorry. I didn't make up the rules. Patients did. So the word Hindu is basically, that's why culture is very important to Hinduism. Hinduism is essentially a culture. It's not just a religion. It's more than a religion. So anyway, that's where the word Hinduism, Hindu comes in. Now the word Hinduism comes much later. Okay? We have to understand the difference. First, the word Hindu, right? So it didn't have any religious connotation at that time. Okay? Now, after around 1700 years later, I'm talking about 1200 AD, that's 1200 years after Jesus Christ, comes the Turkish Empire, Turkish. And in Delhi, there was a Turkish Sultanate, and who are Turkish? What was their religion? Turkish religion, Muslims, right? Yeah, Islamic Empire. Turks were Muslims, so they came and they captured India, and they established their sultanate in Delhi, and then they called everybody in Hind in the sense like they are from India. And you will also hear Ind, that's the Greek, because Greeks cannot even pronounce Hind. So, when you say Sindh, Hind, Ind, it's all kind of the same, okay? So they came and they saw a group of people in the east side of Sindh River or Hind River, and they were called Hindus at the time, but it was not a religion because there were so many different people practicing so many different religions at the time. There is no codified rules or anything like that. So there was it's a mix or amalgamation of different religion, and nobody even called it a religion up to 1200 AD. There was no Hinduism at that time. There were Hindus before, you got that point, right? There were Hindus before 1200 AD, but Hinduism emerged as a religion in 1200 AD because Muslim emperors, they wanted to distinguish their monotheistic Islamic faith from all this, in their eyes, pagan belief. So they thought, we don't want to associate with them. We want to differentiate our religion from all other religion, all these religions we see in this area. So they came up with this term Hinduism as a religion. Okay? Now, there is a theory about some of this, this is a disputed, but this is very academic part of it. But so according to theory, it is called Aryan migration or Indo-European migration, right? So I think it is going to be around 1000 BC or something like that, Aryans came all the way from Europe to India. Aryans or the Europeans came all the way from, Aryans is not a politically correct term anymore, especially after what Hitler did, right? So what happened, I'll just give you a quick example. So if you really look at an Indian, like for example, I'm an Indian guy, technically. So if I have a skin issue and if I become white, and I might look just like a white person if I have the color of my skin. Have you noticed that Indians and Europeans share the same essential body, the features? Very different from Asians and very different from African, So Indians and Europeans have the same structure, body features, except for the color. So the theory is that the Indians here are actually immigrated all the way from Europe. So they came in, around 1200 BC or so, they came and they mixed with the local people there, and they created actually a group of people who will say that they brought religion with them. So essentially the Hinduism, what we know as Hinduism, came from Europe. That's one theory, which Hindus will have a very difficulty accepting it because it's all Western academic, Western scholarship. The one of the proof they say is, for example, Veda. Veda is the fundamental, the most sacred scriptures of Hinduism. The Latin word Veda means science or knowledge. So it's also a Latin word. In Latin, it means knowledge or science. So the Europeans will say that we brought this religion to you. The Vedas are written by Europeans. And or Aryans, we came all the way from there and gave you this religion. But Indians will have dispute, and very often Indians will lose because India doesn't have, India's academic system or scholarship system is very different, right? The Europeans have a very Western, meticulous way of connecting everything. And anyway, this is not extremely important, but for you to give some history. So all religions have their scripture, right? Like right now I read from the Hindu scripture. Islam have their Quran, right? So all religion, Christians have the Bible. So in Hinduism, there are so many different sacred scriptures, and they are essentially classified into two. One is called Shruti, which means revealed scripture, means direct revelation from God, just putting it in Christian term. And the other set of scriptures called Smriti, which is remembered, which is we call an inspired scripture, which is not directly revealed from God, but it is inspired by God. So Shruti, under Shruti comes, there are many, many, but mainly two. One is called Vedas, and the other one is called Upanishad. Vedas is the most sacred scriptures of all, and Upanishads are basically, the best way to explain it is, Upanishads will be more like an interpretation or a commentary on Veda. Right? Like you buy the Bible, and then you have John MacArthur Bible. You have different kind of Bible, which has a different interpretation and footnotes, and basically explain the philosophy of the Bible by somebody else. So there are so many different Upanishads, but basically there are only four Vedas. Rig Veda, I don't know how many of you can see, Rig Veda, Yajur Veda, Sama Veda, Atharva Veda. Rig Veda is again the most sacred because it contains the worship of a creator God and sacrifice rituals and everything. And Yajur Veda is essentially like the book of Leviticus in the Bible. It's mainly the sacrificial rituals, mainly for the priests. And Sama Veda is mostly for individuals, for them to practice religion. And Atharva Veda is a little tricky because it contains a lot of esoteric magic practices and incantations and that kind of stuff. So even in India, people kind of look down on Atharva Veda in the sense it is only meant only if you are initiated. Because they say not pregnant ladies and all should not read it because there is some magic into it, Atharva Veda. So it's a little tricky. And Smriti. Now this is very important. In Smriti, they are basically epics. And two major epics, there are many of them, but two major epics. This is where you have to pay clear attention to. Because even though we say Vedas are the sacred scriptures of Hinduism, nobody really read from Vedas or anything unless you're a priest or unless you're a philosopher. People read from Mahabharata and Ramayana. Ramayana. That's the way I say it, but then, the Western academic system taught me to say Ramayana and all that. Ramayana, that's how you say it. That's what I would say, Ramayana. Which basically means the journey of Rama. The story, we'll talk about Rama in a bit, but he was a king, he was an incarnation, he was an avatar of God, and he's a lovely man, and he had a wife, and his wife was abducted by a demon king in Sri Lanka, and then he had to go and rescue her all the way from Sri Lanka and bring him back. So that's the story of Ramayana, the story of Ramayana, right, Rama's story. And Mahabharata is even more important. It's the story of Krishna, another avatar. But it's essentially the plot of the story is there is this good guys and bad guys. They are brothers, two families, then they get into a fight and Krishna comes in the middle, and I don't have time to explain this. But you have to understand this. Mahabharata is the longest poem ever written. Take that. 1.8 million words. 1.8 million words. The length of Mahabharata, Iliad and Odyssey, which is the Western classics, Homer's Iliad and Odyssey, right? Which is the Greek classic, Greek epics. Now the length of Mahabharata is 10 times more than Iliad and Odyssey combined. Yeah, take that. Take that. So that's a classic poem. I don't know if you will ever finish it, I will encourage you to read it. Actually, that's the book the children version of it, right? That's the first religious book I read, even before I started reading the Bible. I love that book, by the way. Amazing stories, beautiful poetry, philosophy, wonderful. Again, it will be too much for you to read. So what they have is something called Bhagavad Gita. Now, Out of all these books, if you can read only one, you have to read this. Because Bhagavad Gita is essentially an extract from Mahabharata. It's actually, sometimes the Gospel Literature Society take the Gospel of John or Gospel of Matthew and just put it out there so that it's easy for people to read instead of reading the whole Bible. It is something like that. So Bhagavad Gita is an excerpt from, so this is the story. So the good guys are on the other side, one side, and the bad guys are on the other side. And one of the good guys, his name is Arjuna. He is, he is the star fighter of that section. So he was going to fight, but then he realized that who he is fighting to are his brothers. They are kind of family, right? So he kind of freezes in the middle of the battleground. So Krishna, he runs his chariot. So Krishna, who is the Lord Krishna, he comes and gives him advice as to why he should fight. It's a part of the duty and all those philosophy about why he should get into the battle and why he shouldn't be afraid of, committing that soldier, various duty, what have you. So that's the essential plot of it. But Bhagavad Gita is a wonderful, wonderful literature. It will give you like a summary of all the Hindu philosophy and it's probably like the Gospel of John. It's not that long, it's not that big. So it's actually a good book to read. So this is kind of the timeline. I'll read it. Indus Valley civilization is from 2500 BC to 1500 BC. Some would say 3000, 5000. If you ask, if you go to India, some of them will say, oh, it was up to 10,000 BC. He can say all this, but according to scholarship, we have to respect the academic scholarship, which are all unfortunately credited to the Western scholars. Because in India, we don't do this kind of scholar critical methodology. It's not part of India, so we don't do. But this is the most reliable. This is based on a book published by UCLA. So especially we being in Southern California, that's kind of the authority. And the Aryan invasion, yeah, that's right, 1500 BC. So the Indo-Europeans, they come all the way, and they are later known as Aryans, and they say they brought Rigveda in 1200 BC, Rigveda, and then Upanishads came later, 700 BC, and then Mahabharata and Ramayana came between 300 BC to 300 AD. It's very difficult to nail exactly when it was written. So if you ask a Hindu, they will say it was written 3000 BC and all that, but scholarship says it was written somewhere in that area. So this is the problem when you handle most of the Eastern religions. For example, when you study Buddhism, Buddha lived 500 years before Jesus. Buddha lived 500 years before Jesus, but the first written record of his life or his teachings came only 100 years after Jesus. So there's no, we can say Buddha lived 500 years before, but the first record comes only 100 years after Jesus. So you can't really, so then they say, well, Jesus said some of the things which Buddha said, but we don't really know whether Jesus said it, but Buddha, because the whatever you think Buddha said 500 years ago was actually written down only after Jesus' story was written down. So anyway, it's not that we are trying to compete or anything. So this is the problem when you look at it from academic perspective. So I'm going to pause here just for a sec, not for a second, but anybody has a burning question.
Like Bible for the Christianity and the Quran for Islam.
Yeah.
Do they have one religion book to follow?
One scripture. Yeah, it depends on which Hindu you're going to ask. But I will say Bhagavad Gita will be the most critical. That will be the easy way to start. Because I only said about Shruti and Smriti and Veda, Upanishad and epics. Now there are a lot of documents called Shastras, which means science. Have you heard of Vastu Shastra? Vastu Shastra. Which basically means the study of architecture, like some of this fun. Panchwar, yeah, something like that. So it's the study of architecture, and then so that's Shastra. Then there are something called Sutras. Sutras mean techniques. Can you name one Sutra which is very popular in the West, by the way, which is even more popular than Vedas and Bhagavad Gita? Nobody. Somebody has read something. Kama Sutra, which is basically the technique of kama, which is not exactly means sex, but it means sensual pleasure, right? So there are so many scriptures out there, but philosophical Hinduism, we will come to that in a minute. Philosophical Hinduism regard Vedas as the primary scripture, whereas devotional Hinduism will regard the epics, which is Mahabharata and Ramayana, as the main scriptures, and out of which Bhagavad Gita will be a good mix of both. So Bhagavad Gita, even though it comes from that Smriti part or the Mahabharata part, but yet it contains a lot of Vedic truths to it. So I would say Bhagavad Gita would be a good place to start. And if you really want to talk to a normal Hindu in the street, they will be reading more of Ramayana and Mahabharata, right? Feel free to correct me, because I'm really looking forward to you. I appreciate input, feedback too. So I would say all my Hindu friends would be more well-versed with that stories, and that will really affect people. These Vedas and all this, too much philosophy. And it's complicated too.
Does it contain
how
the world was created?
No.
What is the present and what is the world?
See, I'll come to that in a minute. See, Hinduism has a different worldview. I'm going to come to that in a minute. See, this is the problem. We can only think from a Western perspective. Western ideology, we think linear. When was the world created? When was the world going to be destroyed? What is salvation? So we like plotted in a graph, right? Whereas in Hinduism or most of the Eastern religion, it's all cyclical. There is no beginning. There is no end. The world goes round and round and round. So it's a completely different worldview. You have to think completely. It's not a question Hindu will ever ask. Hindus doesn't care who created. Hindus doesn't care about evolution or creation or, you know, they are very pragmatic at that perspective.
And wish you all a happy Diwali and a Sal Mubarak. So.
Asatoma Satkamaya Tamasoma Jyotirgamaya Mrityorma Amrutangamaya Shanti Shanti Shantihi Hari.
I show that because the mantra that priest sang, he said, obviously that's probably the most important mantra in Hinduism. That's why when you have only one shot with the American president, he will pick the best there is, right? So I'm going to assume that mantra he sang, which I heard oftentimes living in India, is coming from one of the Upanishads. I have the reference there too. And it's actually a beautiful prayer, if you ask me. It's a beautiful prayer. I don't want to be in trouble by saying that, but it's my prayer too, in a way. It's my prayer too, because this is what it says. Asadoma Sadgamaya, which means from the delusion or asat, to lead me to truth. And the next verse says Tamasoma. Tamas means darkness. Jyoti means light. From darkness, lead me to light. And the third one, Mrityu means death. And amartam means eternal life. From the death, lead me to life. Now this is what I said. Hinduism is essentially a quest for truth. They don't claim that they have answers. They provoke questions. They ask questions. And in so many ways, we can learn from that inquisitive mentality in Hinduism and Hindu scriptures. And that's beautiful. So we'll come back to this prayer in the end of the seminar. So I want to tell you why I pray this prayer, okay? I'll say that later. I'll save it for later. You know, Christianity, Islam, and Judaism, we are monotheistic, right? That's our philosophy, which means there is only one God, monotheistic. And there is another kind of religion you call pantheistic. You know, pantheistic means, or polytheism, which there are different gods. And Hinduism, essentially, if you want me to summarize this great religion into one word, one philosophy, it's called monistic pantheism. Monism is very different from monotheism. I'll explain that. Don't worry about it. Monistic pantheism, again, don't worry about that word. That's a big word. Essentially, that's what it says. It says, all is one, all is God. I'll say that again. All is one. All is God. I can give you 10 hours, 10 years, you'll never get it. You'll never get it. Because it just, either it means a great thing or it means nothing. That's what it is. How many of you have seen the movie Life of Pi? Life of Pi? Yeah, Anglese movie. And that movie, and Pi is in search for God, and Pi is going to a mosque, and he's going to church, and he's a Hindu, he's going to temple and look for God, and he says, I believe in all this God, God is everywhere, and his dad is an atheist. He thinks from a scientific rationalist perspective, and his dad says the word, if you believe in everything, you believe in nothing. I like that. It's a great twist. So that's kind of the problem when you understand Hinduism from a Western perspective. If you're a Hindu, you're in India, that's not a problem. But when you come from an outsider, Western perspective, you kind of believe in everything. All is one, which kind of means that we are all essentially one, and we are all gods, or God is in us. That's why when we say namaste, namaste is very famous, right, in the Western world. What does that mean, namaste? It comes from two words, nama. If you ask a Hindu, nama means worship. Nama, they go, nama. And te means te, you. So which basically, when a Hindu or an Indian, anybody say namaste, it's basically say, I worship the divine in you. It's basically saying that I recognize you as a fragment of God or God himself, and the divine in me is worshiping the divine in you. And that will drive a Westerner crazy because we can't think from that worldview, right? So essentially, this is what the philosophy is. All is one, all is God. Yeah, I'll explain that, hopefully with some pictures. Basically, there are two circles, right? This is God. It's a big circle, God, and there's a small circle, human. Now, this is the West, not Western, again, I'm saying Abrahamic religions. Islam, Christianity, and Judaism, look at the world, or the cosmology, look at the world from this perspective. So there is this God up in heaven, and there are this human being like us, and there is, you know, God is there and we are here. We are not the same. We are not the same as God. We are created by God. Creator and the creature are different. Creator and creation are different. It is distinctly different. But we are separated by something we call sin. We are separated by sin. And all these three religions offer different ways of bringing this circle from the lower circle to come up. For example, Judaism will say you have to follow a covenant. God gives a covenant. And you follow the covenant and then you can be reconciled and the small circle can come up to the big circle. Islam will say, I have given you a book, the Quran, and I have given you Sharia, which means the way, the law, right? And so if you follow Sharia and then you believe what is in the book, then you can come up. Christianity comes and says, it is not about following a covenant, it's not about following a way, but God himself comes down and he establishes a cross in the middle. And he says, I am preparing a way for you. You don't have to do anything. I am doing things for you. Everything is finished. Just believe it and receive it. So he brings a cross between these two circles, and that's the way we understand the world. Is that clear? That has to be clear because, right? Yeah. So this is our worldview. Now, when we come to Hinduism, or most Eastern religion, it is a very different worldview. Okay, can we switch off the light again? So what you see is here, this is the big circle, which is God. I'm going to tell his name in a bit. This big circle is the God circle, and the small circle is the human circle, us, right? But the small circle is already inside the big circle. It's not like in the Abrahamic religion, it's not separate. We are part of God. We are in God, and God is already in us. That's what we call monism. Because God and human beings are not separate entities. We are in God. I'll explain this. Don't worry about it. So the God in Hinduism is essentially called Brahman. Brahman. Okay? I may not be pronouncing the accurate Sanskrit, but Brahman is actually comes from, the root word comes from breath. Breath. The God is essentially a breath. You see, Book of Genesis, at the time of creation, the spirit hovering over the earth. Like that, God is a spirit, God is a breath. So what is the best way to represent a breath? If I want to explain a breath to you, what should I do? Yeah, exactly. It has to come as a sound, right? I cannot paint a breath. I cannot write about breath. I can write about breath, but you still won't get it. The best depiction of breath is a sound. So the best way to express this Brahman is a sound, which you must have heard, already heard, called Om. 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 So that's a, you know, you must have heard the yoga studio and all that kind of, it's very famous in the popular culture too. Om is the best way to express Brahman. Okay? So there is Brahman, and then the individual souls are called Atman. Individual soul. Whereas the big soul is Brahman. So the individual souls are already inside. So we are not actually separate from God. We are already God. Matthew, John, the person I'm talking, who is talking to you today, right now, I'm God. Or I am Brahman. But why don't I feel that? That's a big question for us, right? Really? But I don't feel it that way. Why? And they say, oh, there's an explanation for that. Because this red circle around you is actually created by something called your ego. Okay? This ego, which means that there is something about I, you know, when you introduced my wife, and I have that sense of, that's my wife, that's my children, this is my church, that's my pastor. You know, we are all born with that my, right? You know, even with the little kids. Everybody has that sense for mine. We want to possess things. So this is our ego. I want to be an engineer. I want to be a pastor. I want to be a doctor. And this is essentially our ego, the word ego. The ego creates the sense of separatedness from God and other people. It is your ego that perceives an illusion that you are different. You are not actually different, but because of your ego, you perceive you are different. So that's an illusion. That illusion has a word, Maya. I'm sure some of you must have heard Maya. Maya is an illusion created by your ego, which makes you think that you are separate from God, but you are not actually different from God. You are Brahman. Okay? Okay? So this is a story. This comes from one of the Upanishads. So when you realize this, when you realize that you are not separate from God, you are part of Brahman, you become enlightened. You must have heard about the word enlightened. So I'm going to give you enlightenment to all of you, right? So the enlightenment comes from simple realization that you are part of Brahman. You are part of God. Okay, I'll explain. So if the story comes from one of the Upanishads, I can give you reference and all that. So there's this son goes to his dad and say, "Hey dad, I want to see Brahman." So dad says, "Oh, you want to see Brahman? Do this first." He gives him a pinch of salt. And the son goes and asks him to put in a cup of water. So son goes and put this salt in the cup of water. And obviously what happens? It dissolves, right? So the son comes and then dad says, "Where is the salt?" Son says, "Well, I don't see it. It's just in the water." So then the dad says, that's exactly how Brahman and Atman are. So then he says a word. This is the word. Wait for it. There's one Sanskrit word you have to learn if you want to study Hinduism. Yeah, exactly. It's called, we have a Hindu brother right here, and he said that word for us. Can you say that aloud?
Aham Brahmasmi.
Aham Brahmasmi, and there's one more word.
Tattvam Asi.
Tattvam Asi. Tattvam Asi. Which basically says, thou art that. You are that. So the dad says to the son, like that salt is in the water, but it disappeared. You think salt is not there, but salt is there. You cannot see it. It became one with the water. So just like that salt became one with the water, thou art that. You are that. Tattvam asi. So the moment you realize, another Upanishad says, the same thing in a different way. He says, Aham Brahmamsi. That's the other word brother said.
Aham Brahmasmi.
Brahmasmi. So forgive my pronunciation. Yeah. Which basically says that I am Brahman. I am Brahman. I am one with Brahman in essence. So the moment you realize that Tattvam Asi or Aham Brahmamsi, you become enlightened. You become come to the realization that all this, you can go beyond all this illusion to realize that you are one with the universe, you are one with the other people, you are one with God. You don't have to search for God because you are already in God. So in the next slide, I try to put it as a dotted line so you can see some dotted line. So the dotted line is when you become enlightened. You realize that what separated you from Brahman was nothing but an illusion. Tattvamasi, aham brahmamsi. So I am basically, essentially one with Brahman. So what happens to you in the end is that when you die, the Atman doesn't exist anymore because the Atman realized that, or the individual soul realized that I'm not an entity even. I am part of this universal existence called Brahman, this universal breath, this universal, the supreme self, you call it. And the word, Hindu word to say that, or Sanskrit word to say is Satchidananda. Satchidananda means Sach Chit Ananda, which means pure being, pure conscience, and pure bliss. So that's the state of ultimate liberation. When you die, if you die as an enlightened being, when you die, you enter into a state we call moksha, which is the liberation. It's very different from heaven and hell and all, we understand. That's there too. But essentially, this is the ultimate quest of a Hindu, to enter into the state of moksha or liberation, where you become Satchidananda, like the universal self himself or itself, because there is no gender there. So itself is Satchidananda, pure being, pure conscience, and pure bliss. Essentially, we are born here, and we are dead here, and based on our good deeds and bad deeds, it's called karma. You know karma, right? Like even the Westerners know what karma is nowadays, right? Basically, based on your deed, depending on your deed, your karma, you enter into a different realm of being, different realm of existence. There can be six different existences in Buddhist understanding of reincarnation anyway, but you can be reborn as an animal, you can reborn as another person, you know, you go into a different level of existence and eventually come back to, you know, so this cycle kind of repeats based on karma. Don't worry, I'll take questions for this. And karma is achieved by doing your dharma. Dharma and karma is very different. So you ask, okay, how do I know karma? Because sometimes I do a good thing, but people don't perceive it as a good thing, right? I'm doing a good thing, but it eventually ends up as a bad thing. A lot of people who became tyrants and bad leaders in this world, essentially they started as a good thing. They wanted to do good thing for the country and all that. But so who is going to decide? Well, honestly, there's no answer. But Hindu will say, you have to do your dharma based on who you are. This is where the whole idea of caste system comes in. You have your dharma already predefined based on the caste in which you are born. I don't want to go into it. It can be controversial. And also, most of the Hindus don't believe these kind of things anymore. If you come from India, it's still there, but it's not essentially part of Hinduism. And many Hindu leaders have publicly rejected some of the scriptures which basically enforce caste system. Anyway, a Hindu, there are four ends of living for a Hindu. There are four, if you're a Hindu, these are your four goals. One is karma, which means doing the right thing. And the second one is artha, which means make money, earn a living. You have to earn a living, you live in the world. And the third one is kama, which we already taught Kama Sutra, which basically means that you just not just earn the money, you can enjoy some sensual pleasures in the world. Hinduism is not exactly an ascetic religion or anything like many people think. You can enjoy karma, and then essentially you achieve moksha, which is the ultimate liberation I talked about, right? So moksha is when you jump off the circle. So I said it's a circle, birth, death. Then again, based on your karma, your life repeats. And one time, and at some point in time, you get enlightened and you break out of the circle. You break. So you're not reborn anymore. You become one with the universal soul. And then you become Satchidananda and you enter into that blissful state which is called moksha. So this process is called yoga. So you become yoga. Yoga means union. Islam seminar, I give them an opportunity to ask questions. And the first question is it okay to do yoga? I'm like, talking about yoga here. I mean, you're talking about Islam, right? So people are dying to know, you know, is it okay to do yoga, right? Okay. First of all, I have to disappoint you. I'm not going to say here, I'm not going to preach here, and I'm going to tell you what is right and what is wrong. Okay? I do that on Sunday mornings, Sundays. So pastors preach on Sundays. Today I'm not going to preach, I'm not going to tell you right and wrong, but I'm going to explain what yoga means. Then you can decide whether you want to do it, or whether it's okay to do it, it's comfortable to do it, but make sure that you're, you know, it's not everybody's piece of cake, like, you know, you have to be kind of physically sort of fit and all that. Anyway, so what is yoga? So, like I said, the ultimate purpose, the ultimate end of human life, according to Hinduism, is to achieve union with the universal soul, or this God who is impersonal or transpersonal, we call Brahman, right? So that is the ultimate end. If you ask a Christian, what is your ultimate goal? I want to go to heaven, I want to see Jesus, right? That's the ultimate goal. But if you ask a Hindu, essentially they want to become one with the union with the universal soul. That is their aim, which is the moksha, state of moksha. Now to enter into that, so moksha is like a graduation. If moksha is a graduation, yoga is your college. Okay, does that make sense? That's an analogy I thought. It just came up in my back of my mind to make it simpler. Which means yoga, okay, let me explain what yoga is. The word yoga literally translated means yoking together. Yoking, Y-O-K-I-N-G. Yoking together. Okay? Or it means union. Okay? Now you get it? So yoga means essentially it's a religious thing. It's a religious thing. Yoga means union, becoming one with the universal soul, one with God, whichever way you want to perceive. Hindus have no problem, whatever way you want to say, if it's your God, it's your God, doesn't matter. But it becoming one with the universal soul, yoking together. Okay? Now, I want you to know that whatever we see in America or wherever as this yoga studios, it's not yoga. Because yoga, in its original sense, it's actually called Ashtanga Yoga. Ashtanga Yoga means a yoga with eight limbs. L-I-M-B-S. Yoga with eight limbs. Ashtanga Yoga. So there are eight processes or eight limbs to this body of yoga. And one of these limbs is called asana, which is body posture, asanas. So that's all we see in these yoga studios. And another one is called pranayama, which means breathing technique. So that also in some yoga studios. And essentially, out of these two limbs are being sold as yogas in the Western market. See, I lived in India for 30 years, and I never seen a yoga studio in India back in the days, in the 80s till I grew up, because yoga was a spiritual discipline, and you know, unless you're spiritual, you don't do yoga, or you know, that had a completely different meaning. But the Westerners came and showed us how to, you know, market it and how to put a label on it, and became successful. Now you go to India, everywhere there are yoga studios, because now they realize we can make money off it. But what you're seeing is not exactly, it's only two limbs of the actual eight limbs. If you're interested, the first two limbs are about morality and ethics and things like that. For example, if you cheat on your wife, the first limb is about morality. I think it's, okay, I don't want to go in there. But essentially, if you're cheating on your wife or you're doing something mean to somebody, you're not. There is no point in you doing all this postures and all that kind of stuff. Because it has, all these limbs have to come together. I know this because I did a lot of research for a television documentary in Canada. Didn't take off, but I did a lot of research for this documentary, which we call Yoga with Lost Limbs. Which is, our thesis was to say that whatever you see in Western yoga, actually they lost the six of the eight limbs. They only take two limbs of the yoga, and this marketed as yoga. That's unfair to Hinduism, to everywhere, to America. So you have to realize that. So yoga has a spiritual connotation, right? Which is a process of becoming one with the universal soul. That's what true yoga. Now, what is that universal soul? Now, this is my friend Kate. She is a model. Kate and I worked on a documentary on different meditation practices, art of meditation. That's why I know a little bit about Lectio Divina and Christian. There are a lot of Christian meditation techniques, actually. Not so many people know that. You don't care much about it, but there are. So, and we did, and Kate actually helped me discover, or, you know, I already knew it, but 15 years ago this was a big thing. And it's called Christian yoga. Now it's popular here too, right? So Christian yoga, you can see the posture she is making, and there's a cross behind it. So they basically took the asanas of the yoga, which is the body postures of the yoga, and sort of Christianized it, right? And then they say, yeah, it is a spiritual thing. It is becoming union, you know, it is becoming one with the universal soul. But for us, that one universal soul is our God. So she would have some of these postures, or which is kind of, you know, some of the postures which is already have yoga, in coming from yoga, but instead of meditating on Om or this universal sound, she would be meditating on Christ, and she would do Christian yoga. Now, is this right or is this wrong? I don't know. Like I said, I won't make a moral judgment of any of this. But what drives me mad is saying that yoga is nothing. You know, whatever we call here in the, you know, Bikram yoga, hot yoga, they really commercialize it. That's worse than Christianizing it, if you ask me, right? I mean, Hindus technically have no issue in the sense you want to use yoga to become one with whatever you call that universal soul, Jesus or whatever you want to call it, fine. But don't say that it's not a spiritual thing. It is a very, very spiritual thing, okay? One thing you probably don't know about is there are four types of yoga. There are many types of yoga, out of which four yogas. There are four types of yogas which are important. Again, these yogas are like going to four different colleges to get the one final certificate. It doesn't matter. For a Hindu, it doesn't matter which college you go to. Ultimately, you have to get your PhD. The PhD is the moksha, being Sachidananda, becoming Sachidananda, right? So look at it as four colleges to register, four ways of, four kind of yogas. Okay, and I'm going to start from the bottom. Raja Yoga, which kind of means royal road, literally translated, which is using a lot of disciplines to achieve this union. And the yoga we see here in the Western world, and the Ashtanga Yoga, is all kind of part of this Raja Yoga. Use different disciplines to achieve union with the universal soul. You don't necessarily have to believe in a god or anything, but through controlling your breathing technique, or, you know, there is something called esoteric practices like Kundalini Yoga. I don't know how many of you heard of Kundalini Yoga. It's a very dangerous practice. It comes from Atharva Veda. There are, like, you know, four Vedas, I said. So the fourth Veda, Atharva Veda, has some kind of black magic or incantation to Kundalini Yoga. If you haven't heard it, there are Hollywood, I know a place where they offer Kundalini Yoga. Buddhists are too much into it. Dalai Lama, the you know, the Vajrayana tradition of Buddhism. Anyway, don't worry about it. Basically, which says that Kundalini is a power, psychic power, which we all have in our spine. And it is coiled like a serpent. Kundalini really means it's a serpent power or a psychic energy which we all have in our back of the spine. So by meditation and practice and saying Om, controlling our breath, this Kundalini can be brought up through the spine to the different areas of the spine called mandalas, or the areas. And depending on the area, you get different powers. So see, that's where yoga becomes dangerous, right? Especially if you don't know what you're doing. Most of the people here have no clue what they're doing. So it ends up in psychosis. Some people go crazy because it is kind of crazy unless you know what you're doing, right? So Raja Yoga is a little tricky part of that, and what we are doing today, like the body postures, it's actually the subdivision called Hatha Yoga, not hot yoga, Hatha Yoga. Hatha Yoga is basically about body postures and breathing techniques, mostly body postures, asanas and pranayamas. So these are all under Raja Yoga. So essentially, take it as kind of techniques, practices. You know, you don't have to believe in a god per se or anything. But yet, it's a spiritual thing, right? Okay, let's leave that. Karma Yoga. Karma Yoga is, again, not that popular, but Dr. Walsingham said, an important thing, Mahatma Gandhi is probably the most popular Hindu you already know. And Mahatma Gandhi is a classic example of what Karma Yoga means. Karma Yoga means the road to union, which is the yoga, through your work or your action. Okay? So the fundamental principle of Karma Yoga is, because I'm not very interested in Karma Yoga or Raja Yoga, because these two schools don't teach God. Like he said, you don't have to believe, like Gandhi said, you don't have to believe in a particular God. Even if you're an atheist, you can still do Karma Yoga and get your final certificate. So Karma Yoga says something called Nishkama Karma. Forget the word. Basically it means a work, do your work without expecting anything in return. That's like something like Jesus said, right? So essentially, you remember that small circle I showed you, right? The small red circle, Atman inside the big. So the principle of Karma Yoga is this. Whenever you do a work, a particular action, with an interest or with a motivation to get something for you, a layer is added to your ego, right? If I come here and do this seminar to be a star, right? I want to be the next expert on Hinduism, or I want to make $5,000. They are going to give right after this. Just kidding. So if I'm doing that because I'm doing it because of that, that small circle, that red line is getting thicker and thicker because it's adding to my ego, right? So as opposed to if I'm doing something without expecting any remuneration, without expecting any reward, a layer is being taken away from that red circle. Eventually that red circle becomes, which diminishes. That becomes, that's how you achieve that yoga, which is the union with the universal soul. You got that, right? So the idea is like he said, it's Nishkama Karma, which means doing work without expecting anything in return, which is what Gandhi did, which is amazing. In a way, Gandhi is a poster boy of Karma Yoga. And so God is not even in the question. So I'm not interested in Karma Yoga for the time being. I'm interested in the first two, which is actually has something to say about God and is more important. Most of the Hindus follow one of these two yogas. So Jnana Yoga is way of knowledge. And don't worry, almost 90% of the Jnana Yoga we already talked. We talked about Jnana Yoga, I'll explain that. And the next one is called Bhakti Yoga, which is the way of devotion. One is the way of knowledge, one is the way of devotion. And they both have a concept of God, or Supreme Being, whatever you call it. So here we have this something called Brahman, right? Brahman is this impersonal or transpersonal entity. It's more like... how many of you have seen Star Wars? Star Wars, right? Star Wars. Okay. Thank you. So, Star Wars, like, may the force be with you, right? They mean God, but they don't want to call it God because it's a he or he, she or a it. There's no personality. It's like the force of Star Wars. That's the best way to understand Brahman. So, you have this impersonal Brahman, and all these arrows are basically Atmans. We are all coming from the heart of Brahman. We are all part of it, but we have all this individuality which we presume because of the illusion. So Vedas and Upanishads and all that deal with the Jnana Yoga. Now if you go to India and if you talk to an actual Hindu, most of the people don't care about this. And correct me if I'm wrong, because philosophical Hinduism is very different from average person practicing their religion. And the universities in America and everywhere, we try to go to this philosophy about Brahman and Atman, and an average Hindu doesn't have time to think about that, because it, like some of you are asking me questions about, well, if Atman and Brahman are same, and you know, how can we be different, then how, what does it mean being, yeah, actually there's no answer to many of this question. You cannot, in a justifiable way, give a clear answer to some of the philosophical things we discussed. Believe me, you know, many people have tried. It's very difficult. It's esoteric. But the Hinduism which is popular, I'm going to say a majority of the Hindus are practicing something called Bhakti Yoga, devotional Hindu. Because, you know, eventually we are all human beings. We need a God. See, that's the way we are wired, right? We can talk about philosophy all that you want, but when you're kid is diagnosed with a cancer, or when you are going through that unexpected firing from the job, you need something or somebody to cry out to. This philosophy won't help you, right? You know what I mean? You can say, oh yeah, I'm one with the universe or so, blah, 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 but then you have to pay your electricity bill. You have to pay your lease, right? Yeah, I cannot say that it's all illusion. You know, I'm being honest here. I'm being very candid here. So this is all like this. These philosophers really mess up Hinduism, if you ask me. You know, because most of them are either university lecturers, which they are getting paid to talk about this, and or monks, which they don't have electricity bills, right? They don't have kids, so they can just sit in their cloister and come up with this philosophy. And I'm not being mean, but it kind of, as a pastor, it breaks my heart how people are being deceived into vain philosophy, even though I accept the nobility part of it. But thankfully, most of the Hindus I know, and I'm going to say all the Hindus I know, follow a devotional part of Hinduism. They believe in God. They believe in God. And they want that God to enter into their life. They are just like Christians. They are just like anybody else. They want a God who is out there, and they know they are separated from God, whatever you call Maya or, you know, all that kind of stuff. But they want to reach out to that God. Now, that's why devotional Hinduism is sometimes it's very close to Christianity. I'll explain that. So devotional Hinduism also has a God. Now, this God is a personal God. He is not the force of the Star Wars. So, Jnana Yoga promotes a God who is impersonal, and they call it Nirguna Brahma. Nirguna Brahma means a Brahman or a God with no attributes. No attributes. It's a force, it's a power, it's a sound. That's what it is. Whereas in Bhakti Yoga, the God has a personal attribute. It's called Saguna Brahma. Saguna Brahma means a God with personal attribute, just like the God we all know. Christians know, Muslims know. They all believe in a God who is a person. Call it a he or she, that's the next question. But there's a God. And normally that God is called Ishvara. Ishvara. Or Bhagavan. Sometimes they call Bhagavan, depending on your language. So Bhagavan or Ishvara is the Saguna Brahma, whereas Brahman is the Nirguna Brahma. Okay? So devotional Hinduism. And this Ishvara manifest himself in three different ways. Okay? It's called Trimurti. It's very different from Trinity, but he has this, I'm just going to call him he, you know, forgive me, but he, that he is going to manifest himself in three different ways. And there are three gods, Brahma. Now that Brahma is different from Brahman with the N. You know, Brahman with the N goes to this category. This is Brahma, it's different. I'll show his picture. So I have pictures of all gods. That's a good thing. That's a good thing about Hinduism, right? So I have pictures, so you'll get it clear. So Brahma and Vishnu and Shiva. So there are three manifestations of this one Ishvara. And Brahman is the God who creates. Sorry, Brahma is the God who creates. And Vishnu is the God who preserves the world, and Shiva is the God who destroys it. Now herein lies the irony of your question about where is the world. So because Hindus believe that God, the world is going through a cycle of creation, preservation and destruction. They believe the world is going to destroy, to be destroyed like the apocalypse. But they believe that it's going to come back again. So it's a circular motion. It doesn't end or it doesn't begin. So Christians believe, you know, so there was a creation. Most of the Abrahamic religion, there was a creation. We all live. And then eventually this apocalypse and, you know, all these kind of calamities happen. Then we enter into another realm of existence we don't know. But Hindus believe, yeah, it will happen. It will come back again. So it's a cyclical process. So Ishvara controls this cyclical process of cosmic drama or dance, whatever you call, through this manifestation of three different gods. Brahma who creates, and Vishnu who preserves, and Shiva who destroys. Again, I'll show you everybody's pictures. But then you have Brahma doesn't, you know, people don't worship Brahma. There are different reasons for it. I don't want to get into it. The only two gods being worshipped are basically Vishnu and Shiva. Okay, Vishnu and Shiva are being worshipped. And Vishnu worshippers are called Vaishnavites. Obviously, those who follow Vishnu. And Shiva worshippers are called Shaivites. So if you really go to India, it is very unlikely you're going to meet anybody who talks about this philosophy, Atman, Brahman. Most of the people are either Vaishnavites and or Shaivites. Either they worship Vishnu or they worship Shiva. That's what essentially it all going to come down to. Okay? There are 330 million manifestations of this one God. Okay? So 330 million deities in Hinduism. So I'm not going to get into that, obviously, for the next 20 minutes. But these four people, if you know, these four gods you know, you will pretty much cover most of the Hindus. So, Vaishnavites, there are two main gods. I'll come to that. It's called avatar, like, you know, we already mentioned. There are 10 avatars, out of which these two avatars are very important. Rama and Krishna. Right? Rama and Krishna. I'll come to that. Again, show you pictures. Then, Shaivites normally worship a goddess called Shakti. I'll explain what it is. And then Ganesha. Ganesha is the most favorite god with the elephant head, right? So that's a Shaivite god, and the other one are the Vaishnavite god. I'm going to explain this in a bit. But this, to me, is very important. And this is also interesting. These are stories. So forget all the philosophies. If you got confused, forget it. I don't think it's really applicable to you unless you enter into an academic platform and have a debate on this. Real people, real Hindus, are here, right here, in the Bhakti Yoga tradition. They are normal people like all of us. They have normal issues like all of us. And they worship, actually, the manifestation of this Ishvara in different forms. So they believe, even though there are 330 million gods, it's all manifestations of one God. I'll give you proof to that in the end. So here is the picture of Hindu Trinity. I'm now going to... So beautiful looking gods. Most of them look blue. And you identify, because blue is the color of infinity, right? I mean, it's symbolic. It's symbolic, right? It's symbolic. And so Brahma has actually four heads. Anyway, I'm not going to go into the symbolism. So this is the God who creates, this is the God who preserves, and this is the God who destroys. Brahma, Vishnu, Shivan. Everything you see see, for example, this water coming out of Shiva's head is actually the river Ganges. You know the river Ganges, right? Which is the holy river in India. It's actually coming out of Shiva's head. So everything you see is so. I mean, if you're a student of arts and images, it's so beautiful in a way, right? So it's symbolism, and this is Shiva. Shiva, this is another manifestation of Shiva. Shiva is called Artha Narishwaran, which means half man and half woman. So in Shiva, this is the god who destroys, the third god, right? Third god. He normally manifests half as a man and half as a woman. And the other half is his wife called Parvati. Okay? And Parvati again has a couple other manifestations. So they are together, they are also called Shiva Shakti. Okay? Shiva is the male part and Shakti is the female part. So in Shiva there is this feminine energy and the masculine energy. So it's symbolism, right? It's all cosmic principles. And don't try to look at it like Christians. If you try to look at it from the Western perspective, then you will get confused. But this is the symbolism of Shiva. And Shakti, important to know her because Shiva's wife Parvati also manifests as two other goddesses. This is more like a mother goddess called Durga, and this is Kali. And her picture is what projected at the Empire State Building. I showed you the first slide, right? Empire State Building, they projected her face. So this is like, they are both together, Parvati, Durga, and Kali. They are together called Shakti, and she is like the mother goddess. You know, that's important. In the Western culture, there's this movement called mother goddesses, right? You know, goddess movement. You haven't heard about this? In the feminist circle, there's a big goddess movement in the Western world. I'm not talking about India. Western world. So when they talk about it, this is what actually the mother goddess look like. The manifestation of a mother. Here, she is more of a caring mother. And you will see, she is riding on a tiger, I think. So everything has a meaning. And here, actually, Kali is stepping on Shiva himself. Now, I don't know what it means because it doesn't really. Not all the wives do that, right? Like the wife. So, but again, it's a part of symbolism. So Shakti Shiva, Shakti. You probably have seen this picture. This is another way of representing Shiva. It's called Nadaraja, which means dancing god. These are some of the symbolism very popular in the Western culture, so I picked it. So dancing god means they believe that Shiva always dances. Shiva is a dancing god. He lives in Kailasa, which is a Himalaya, but he is always dancing, and his dance beat is actually controlling the rhythm of the world. And the moment he stops dancing, the world is going to end. So that's the mythology behind it. So that's why he's a dancing god, Nadaraja. I'm just explaining because you will see some of these pictures here in America. And this is a nice family picture of Shiva. I like that. Basically, Shiva and his wife Parvati, and she's like in a Parvati form, like not Durga and Kali. That's only when time situation demands. And they have an older son who is more popular in the southern part. I think Bala Subramanya. There are a lot of people, especially from the southern part, like in Tamil and Malayalis. There are a lot of Bala Subramanya. I haven't seen a lot of northern people worshipping Bala Subramanya, but that's the old. There is, right? Okay, but he is very famous, right? Like Ganesha. Ganesha is very famous, who is the god. I have an individual picture of Ganesha. So this is Ganesha, and very, very famous in India and in America. First of all, because he looks very cute. And also in Appu, the Simpsons, Appu made him very famous. But the story of what happened was, he was obviously the son of Shiva and Parvati, or Shiva and Shakti. Right, and so he was guarding his mother's bedroom one night, and then Shiva went into the bedroom, and he didn't understand it was Shiva, it was his dad. So he kind of tried to stop him, and Shiva got mad. That's why dad got mad for stopping him on the way. So Shiva, in his anger, cut his head off, his son's head off. And then he realized, oh man, the light came on, and it's my son, and it was a mistake. So he took the first animal, or whatever came to his view for the first time, it was an elephant. So he cut the elephant's head and put it on his body. That's how he got the elephant head. And he also appointed him as the leader of his army. That's how the name Ganesha. Isha means God. Isha, God. Gana means the army, or the group, or the gang, whatever. So he appointed him as Ganesha. His name is Lord Ganesha, which means the leader of the army. So most Hindus pray to him because he is the leader of the army, and he is also known as the remover of the obstacles. Remover of the obstacle. That's what we normally pray, right? Even when you go to, even if you are a Christian, most of the time you pray when you have some obstacles you want to be removed. It's a shame, but, you know, unfortunately, but that's the way it is. So that's one of the reasons Ganesha became very popular, because he is the remover of the obstacles. He is the leader of Shiva's army, okay? Now, this is Vishnu, okay? So this way, right now you are at Shiva, right? Shaivites, main goddess Shakti, and another god, Ganesha, right? And there are so many other gods I didn't touch, because it's not that relevant for our discussion. So Vishnu is the god who preserves. And Vishnu normally sleeps in a cosmic ocean, and there's a snake. Anyway, I don't want to go into symbolism. That's his wife, called Goddess Lakshmi. Goddess Lakshmi is also the goddess of wealth and beauty, right? So if you want to have a commercial for Dove or something like that, you want Lakshmi is the beauty and wealth. And one thing about Vishnu is that Vishnu manifests himself in different forms, and that's where the word avatara comes from. Avatar. You remember James Cameron? So Vishnu descend from the spiritual realm into the world, into the human realm, to accomplish specific tasks. Even though Vishnu is God and who lives in this ethereal cosmic realm, he descend in human flesh to come down and do some task in this world. So that's called avatar. There are many avatars, but collectively they pick 10 of them and call it Dasha avatar. Dasha means 10. So 10 avatars. These are the 10 avatars. We have no time to go into all the 10 avatars. Actually, we are celebrating Onam today, right? Onam today or this week?
No, the coming week.
coming week. So that's actually the one of the avatars, I think Vamana, one of the avatars. But the most important of this avatar is Rama and Krishna, to which we will come in a bit. Interesting thing though, do you know Christianity and Hinduism are the only two religions who believe in the concept of avatar? Now that's very interesting. Because if you tell a Muslim that God will come down as a human being, that's a blasphemy. God cannot come as a human being. And if you say that to a Jew, they won't accept that. Sikhs will not accept that. Buddhism doesn't even have a concept of God, so forget them. But all religion, you know, only Hinduism and Christianity believe that the transcendent God can come down as a human being in a human flesh. The difference though is that in Hinduism it can be many, but Christians believe there was only one avatar, only one descent which we... But yet that's an interesting concept in devotional Hinduism, which is the main Hinduism if you ask me. So these are the two avatars, out of the 10 avatars, these are the two major avatars. I know they look the same. This is Krishna and Rama. Like I said, most of the gods look the same. They're beautiful and they're blue. But the main difference, how you identify, is the way they carry their instrument. Each god is assigned an instrument. For example, Krishna will always carry a flute. And Rama normally carries a bow and an arrow. Right? So Hindus know, worship mainly. So even if you forget everything I said to this point, if you get these two gods, because I will say if you randomly do a random survey of Hindus, most of the Hindus will be focusing mainly on these two gods, right? Right? Yeah, so thank you. Thank you for confirming. Because Rama and Krishna are the main. So if you get Rama and Krishna, you kind of get what a Hindu soul really is. So they're very popular. And some say Krishna is the only Purna Avatara, which means complete incarnation. All the avatars are partial. But some traditions say both Rama and Krishna are Purna Avataras. But mainly, according to one of the Acharya, I don't want to go through all these references, but they say live as Rama lived and teach as Krishna taught. Krishna is a great teacher. Bhagavad Gita is actually the songs of Krishna. Bhagavad Gita means songs of the Lord. So Bhagavad Gita, that book I asked you to read, it's what Krishna taught. And Rama is not a teacher, but he is a doer. He is a karma yogi. He was a prince and he was a king. And so he was a noble man. A great example of what life should be from the Indian perspective. Hinduism teaches something called Sanatana Dharma. If you're going to ask a Hindu scholar and summarize Hinduism into one word, this is what they will call it. Called Sanatana Dharma. They won't even call Hinduism as a religion. Our religion is called Sanatana Dharma, which means universal duty, universal principle. And it comes from this, I don't have the reference, but I'm sure it's from Rig Veda. It says, Ekam Sat Vipra Bahuda Vadanti, which means that which exists is one, sages call it by various name. So many Hindus will claim that they are monotheists. Well, that's what this word says. We believe in only one God. And if you really looked at both Jnana Yoga and Bhakti Yoga, it's actually one God, but it's all these 330 million manifestations are all leading to the same God. So essentially, in the theology of Hinduism, it is about that one God reaching out to humanity. And when I started this, I read from Rig Veda, it's about that one God coming to this world as a child. It's very interesting. So that's actually a very interesting concept. Hinduism essentially, they say essentially it is monotheistic. We believe one God. Even though you might see different manifestations of it. See, that's the tricky. Hinduism is so tricky. You can nail it. You cannot come to a point that, oh, I understood it now. Because it will slip away. Because on one side it is monotheism, and the other side it is pantheism, because there are so many different gods. But on the other side, there's only one God. Then other side you go to karma yoga, there's no God. Doesn't matter. As long as you get your diploma, if you get into karma yoga or raja yoga, you don't have to believe in God. You still achieve Moksha liberation. So, you know what I mean? It's very tricky. What is the connection of Christian? I mean, how do I look at Hinduism as a Christian? Like I said, Hinduism is the religion I respect the most as a Christian. And not only, and I'm, you know, I always address myself as a Hindu in the sense culturally, like I said before. And I am very proud of that. And unfortunately, one of the mistakes Christians did, you know, in India, I mean, something I really regret, is that Hindus don't necessarily have a problem for for Christians or Muslims or anybody to come to their country and teaching their religion. Technically, they don't have any problem. The problem is, when they come to the soul of Hinduism, they don't respect the culture. I'll just give you a quick example, very simple example. When we got married, Joanne and I got married, and I know some of you married, Christians wear white dresses, right? Right? Like Christian marriages, they almost always use white dress when they go to the wedding, right? And because that comes from a Western tradition. The Western understanding of white as this holy color, and you know, the bride in their white dress, and you know, the big thing. But did you know white is the color of a widow in Hinduism? In Hindu culture, white is the color of mourning. White is the color of sadness. So I still remember there was this brother, I mean, the real story, my professor said, they went and preached in India, one lady wanted to get baptized. And then her husband didn't like it, but she said, I want to get baptized, I'm a Hindu, I want to become a Christian. She was going to get baptized, and her husband said, okay, if you want to get baptized, fine. So when she was coming for baptism, he got all crazy and he came in a big havoc, and because she was wearing white when she was going to baptism, because it was telling to the culture, it was saying to everybody around that my husband is dead. You know what I mean? But if you go to a Hindu wedding, it's colorful. It's like Bollywood, right? Like why people like Bollywood? Not because of great stories. It's just beautiful, the dress and everything, because that celebration, that festivity. So Christians, you know, we do this, you know, in our wedding, Joanne wore this white dress, and then at the time of reception, she changed it into this colorful sari. Why? Why do we have that double standard? Why can't we get married as, like, with the colorful Bollywood dress, right? You know what I mean? Because it's a Western, it's not in the Bible. The Bible doesn't say you have to wear white when you get married. Again, I'm not creating any culture, but I want you to understand. The Hindus don't have a problem with Jesus, or even Christianity to that extent. But you have to always remember that Christianity is looked at as the religion of the oppressors. Because India was a British colony. So we cannot get away from that stigma, right? Because it's the religion of the oppressors, the religion of the Westerners. So even when in India, when we become Christians, I remember at the time of my baptism, all my neighbors said, oh, he is getting paid from CIA. ignorant people, but they say, because we are all spies of Americans. The American CIA is paying them. That's why they are bringing the Westerners. Again, it is nothing about Jesus. It's not a disrespect for Christianity or the Bible they are doing. It's a cultural thing. So we have to be very, very sensitive from a cultural perspective. And that sari, I think, is a great example. So, you know, if I knew this before, I would have asked Joanne to wear a nice Bollywood sari at the time of a wedding. Not the white. And she looked very pale in that wedding picture, too. And anyway, I had a nice suit, though. Yeah, so anyway, coming back. So Rig Veda, essentially, there is this quest for God, that one God in Hinduism. It's so buried deep down. It doesn't come out. It comes out as polytheism and all this. They worship all this crazy God. One looks like an elephant. One looks like a monkey. That's what people make fun of Hindus. But actually, in the deep down, there's a quest for truth which you have never seen. It's so philosophically that there is this deep respect for the supreme beings, the supreme light, that one creator God from Rig Veda, which is the essence of Hinduism. It says, with the eyes on all sides and mouths on all sides, with arms on all sides and feet on all sides, the one God created the sky and earth. Doesn't it sound like Bible at least? You know what I mean? I mean, this is not a pantheistic perspective. Unfortunately, this got buried down. That's a completely different thing. So, fanning them with his arms. And then again, the All-Maker is vast in mind and vast in strength. He is the one who forms, who sets in order, and who is the highest image. So, what I'm saying is that a Hindu has the perception of that God out there who's looking down, who created us, and who likes to have a relationship with us. And they do have it. And Hinduism teaches us that. Even though it gets muddled in these philosophical jargons and this Atman Brahman philosophical systems. So it is out there buried deep within. And one of the ways Hindus do it is the, you know what this is? It's a sacrifice. Right? So Hinduism, the essence of most Hindu ritual is a sacrifice. They offer an animal, not anymore, because blood sacrifices are, I don't think it's legal anymore. It's just like Judaism, right? You read the Old Testament, it's all about sacrificing animals. But do you think any Jews do that today? No, they replace it with symbols. So Hindus don't do it that often. There are some temples and all that do this. You know, they sacrifice chickens or goats, and you know, there are some temples do it, but not in a big way anymore. But essentially, the core of Hindu theology or ideology is that by doing sacrifice, we can come near to God. Now, have you heard that somewhere else? It's in the Bible. That's what the Bible says too, right? The Old Testament. So there is this idea of sacrifice. And then again, you wonder why God has this thirst for the blood of the animals and all that kind of stuff. What does it make, you know, does that mean anything? So there's this thing. This is very controversial, so I'm not going to explain it in detail. I'll give you some time for question and answer. So if you read the Rig Veda, again, sacredtext.com, it's available free if you get time and you have nothing else to do, read it. If you read Rig Veda, the main Veda, the creation of the world happens by this created deity. His name is Prajapati. Okay? Prajapati. There is this created deity, Prajapati. He is also called Purusha, which means the ultimate man, human, ultimate human. So this created God offers himself as a sacrifice. And it's very clearly seen. So this, and from his different parts of his body comes different kind of people. I think Brahmanas come from his head, or I don't know. Like different parts of the body come different people. So there is one created God sacrificing himself, becoming a sacrifice, and from his sacrifice comes this creation. And indeed, there was no other victim for sacrifice but that one Prajapati. They did offer him up. These were the first ordinance. So all the sacrifices, according to this school of teaching, all the sacrifices in Hinduism is a symbol of this one big sacrifice done by this created deity called Prajapati. Okay? And interestingly, one of the attributes, there are many, this is another 3 hours, but one of the attributes, very interesting, now one half of the Prajapati was mortal and the other half was immortal. Which means this Prajapati was God and man at the same time. Okay? So I went to Delhi recently, I mean not recently, 3 years ago. I met a group of people. They call themselves Christians and they call themselves Hindus. So they've invited me to a worship, their worship service, and they worship Prajapati. So that's why, and they say, this Prajapati is Jesus. And so I said, the Prajapati worship, and they have this idol of Jesus Christ in the middle, and they have an open Bible, and they do like a Hindu-style prayer to the Prajapati. They say, Jesus is the Prajapati. Because Jesus himself, through his sacrifice, he brought life to the world, and he was both man and God at the same time. And they also have this 9 different attributes of Prajapati Yajna. They call Prajapati Yajna or sacrifice of the Prajapati. There are 9 attributes to the sacrifice of the Prajapati, and all those 9 attributes were fulfilled in the crucifixion of Jesus. That's what they say. It goes a little crazy. I don't want to show it because some conservative Christians call it a cult, because they are not Christians, they are not Hindus, they are somewhere in the... Does that make sense? So Christians don't want to look at the Mayan man like this is a little crazy. I mean, it's good to have a bridge to understand. Yeah, it's beautiful to think that at the core of Hinduism is the essence of the sacrifice, that this one God sacrificing himself, which is essentially the principle of Christianity too, right? So it is great to know that, but sometimes that bridge becomes an entity in itself. But it is interesting. But it is interesting for me as a Christian to know that there is that connection. So Jesus, but if you ask a Hindu, who is Jesus? And they will say, you know, there's no problem for a Hindu to say that Jesus was a yogi. Yogi means one who achieved union with the universal soul, which is the yoga. One who mastered yoga. So yogi, you know, Jesus said, I and the Father are one. Remember? So that they will say that's a way of saying that I am one with the universal soul, right? So a Hindu will say Jesus as a yogi. And because Jesus is a yogi, he can also be a guru. Because he can teach you the way to enlightenment. That's beautiful. That's a very respectful way of looking at Jesus. And they will also say, Jesus was an avatar. Jesus is an avatar. By the way, I said there are 10 avatars, right? 10 avatars. And the last avatar, which has not come yet, this is the last avatar which is going to come at the end of the world. So this avatar, the 10th incarnation of Vishnu, is called Kalki. K-A-L-K-I. Kalki. Okay? This is how Kalki is going to come at the end of the world to destroy. Have you seen this picture? Does this resonate something which you have already as a Christian?
Yes. Revelation.
Yeah, this is the book of Revelation, right? This is the book of Revelation, all the horsemen of the apocalypse, and this final return of Jesus Christ. And so Hindus are also waiting for the return of this avatar, a Kalki, is going to come. And so a Hindu normally has no problem to say that, like Rama and Krishna were avatars in India, Jesus was an avatar in the Middle East. They have no problem. They have no problem accepting Jesus as a God. Well, it's 330 million anyway, so what's, you know, it's okay to add one more, right? I mean, I'm saying it in a very respectful way. So no Hindu has a problem accepting Jesus as a God, as an avatar of Vishnu, or that universal soul, transpersonal being, Ishwara, or, you know, Saguna Brahma. There is no problem at all. But he cannot be the one and the only. Now, that's where the problem comes. So this is, anyway, it's an excerpt from the scripture about Kalki, the final avatar, and I'm going to go there. Basically, I explained, this is the end of Kali Yuga. The Hindus believe that we live in an age called Kali Yuga, which means the age of Kali, means everything bad, perverted, a perverted age. And then Kalki is going to come and end this world, and he is going to create a new world called Satya Yuga, okay, which means the age of truth. See, it's again the book of Revelation. The old is gone, the past is gone, everything is new. So this new final avatar who is going to come is going to establish a new world of Satya Yuga. This is one thing you have to understand. The purpose of avatar in Hinduism is very clearly, this is an excerpt from Bhagavad Gita. So this is what Krishna says. What is the purpose of the avatar? Krishna says, when goodness grows weak, when evil increases, I make myself a body. In every age I come back to deliver the holy, to destroy the sin of the sinner, to establish the righteous. Got it, right? I will come here every age when bad guys are overtaking the good guys. I'm going to establish the righteousness and justice. I'm going to save the good guys and destroy the bad guys. Makes sense. Right? Makes sense, right? So that is the purpose of each avatar. Now, Jesus, like I said, normally Hindus have no problem accepting Jesus as an avatar. You know, in the Middle East or something, he is also an incarnation of God. The difference between the Jesus avatar, this is what Jesus said. For the Son of Man has come to seek and to save that which was lost. I'll give you couple seconds for it to sink in, right? Like, you know, to get it. So this is the difference Jesus made. He is an avatar which came to this world with a diametrically different purpose. He did not come here looking for the good guys. If he came to this world looking for the good guys, I'll be the first person out of this room. I'm being very candid here. And I believe if God came to this world looking for good people, he came to the wrong planet. He came to the wrong planet. That's why Jesus said, I am an avatar, but I did not come here looking for the good guys. I came here to seek and save that which was lost. And I accept, and I see your brokenness, and I see your pain, and I see your agony, and I know you cannot do anything of your own. So I am here looking for you to save that which was lost. And that is the beautiful thing. And as a Hindu, in a way, again, culturally, and I look at Jesus as the avatar, he's very diametrically different from all the other avatars. It was a quote from Life of Pi again. Pi says, I couldn't imagine Lord Krishna consenting to be stripped, naked, whipped, mocked, dragged through the streets, and to top it off, crucified under the hands of mere humans to boot. I would never heard of a Hindu god dying. Why would God wish that upon himself? Why not leave death to the mortals? Why make dirty what is beautiful, spoil what is perfect? Love. That's what Father Martin's answer. I mean, this is from the book, obviously, not from the movie. Life of Pi was actually a book, and this is actually spoken by a Hindu in the novel. So this is a very different... I still remember when I was in college, I attended a seminar done by Swami Nitya Chaitanya Yadi. Do you remember Swami Nitya Chaitanya Yadi? It was very popular in the 80s. Maybe you were not even born at the time. Okay, anyway. Swami Nitya Chaitanya Yadi was very famous and wonderful leader from the southern part of India. So I attended this. You know, I was very interested in religion and so study. And so he walks into this platform, and this is how he starts this lecture. So he's looking at, there was this pictures of different gods, and so it's casual, he's not even lecture. So he looked at all these pictures and said, see, look at all the pictures of God and look at the picture of Jesus. He's not a Christian, obviously, he's a Hindu. Look at the picture of Jesus. And then he says, do you see anything different about Jesus? He says, you know, all our gods, in a way, they are all very angry, or they are very excited, they are happy. And then you look at the picture of Jesus. In all pictures of Jesus, after that I look at all the pictures of Jesus, there is this pain, there is this sorrow. Have you noticed that about Jesus? Whenever artists portray Jesus, there is this deep within, inside his eyes or inside his heart, you see there is a sorrow. There is a pain. So Nitya Chaitanya Yadi was saying that there is something about the Christian God I always wonder. It's like he carry my pain. And I look at him and it talks to me. It connects to me in a different way. And I will never forget that. I'll never forget that. I never learned such a beautiful lesson from any Christian pastor. I mean, this guy taught me a lesson to look at Jesus' picture. And it's amazing. Because you don't see any Jesus picture like happy, or, you know, Jesus is always sad. Even when he's smiling, there is something sadness about him, because he came to a broken world. He went through our brokenness. He carried the pain of the world. And he was the Lamb of God who carried the sins of the world. And that pain, that agony, and that makes him a very, very different God, like in Life of Pi said. That's a different conception of God. And just to end, another major difference is that, so, you know, how many of you have a Bible? Like, you know, all Bible, at the end, you have this maps, right? Most, you know, the Bible. And you look at Bhagavad Gita, you won't see a map. You look at Quran, there won't be any map. Bible is the only book which has all the map, which even Christians don't look at it. What's wrong with, you know, we normally write our notes on the map because it doesn't really matter to us. But because I want you to know, it's very important, because Christianity, the difference between Christianity and any other religion, particularly Hinduism and Eastern religion, is that Christianity is a very, very historical religion. And it is very particular about the history. And Hinduism on the other extreme is completely different. They don't care whether Krishna existed or not, Rama existed or not. But they don't care whether the gods have different hands or not, because it is all mythical symbol or something, transcendent values which we don't understand. You won't offend a Hindu if you say your god never existed. They will say, we don't care. That's not what you're saying, because these are universal principles. Like Krishna had 16,008 wives. And he said, your wife is like Muhammad. Muhammad had different wives. No, Hindus have no problem saying that, because all the 16,008 wives represent something has cosmic significances, right? Because it is not, Hinduism doesn't care about history. It's a very different perception of history, whereas all the Abrahamic religions, particularly Christianity, the authenticity of Christianity stay, rise and fall based on history. So that's why the whole idea of resurrection and all that, Hindus will say, we believe Jesus is resurrected, we can believe Jesus is resurrected because it's all symbol, Deepak Chopra, it's all symbolism. No, but Christians said, no, we want to say that it is a historical fact. There is this empty tomb, and then a Hindu will wonder, why should you worry about that? I don't care, right? I believe it. I believe it. I don't care about it. Don't worry about it. But Christianity is very particular because it's a historical, we believe God's intervention in history. So many Hindu friends I know will say that all this cosmic revelation of God, this mythical explanations of God, our search for this eternal being is finally landed in history, crystallized right in the middle of Palestine. So the difference is that this cosmic mythical God of Hinduism, which is called Prajapati, or whoever who sacrificed himself, that eternal symbol the Hindus have been waiting for, and that could be Jesus who revealed himself in history in a tangible way. So I have many Hindu friends who believe that, which says that Jesus is a historical avatar as opposed to the cosmic avatar. And if you have any doubt, like Varsanango said, from September 20th, we start a series here at the, you know, it's Tuesdays, and we are going to study a topic called Life and Times of Jesus Christ. So it's going to be a 4 to 5 week series, and we are going to study the historical part. We are going to go through this map, and we are going to study who are the characters in the gospel, like who are the scribes and who are the Pharisees and who are this, some of the emperors who are mentioned in the Bible. So these are very important for Christianity, the historical aspect of it. So we are going to do that. So the point is, again, is the historical manifestation of a cosmic truth or cosmic mythical reality. And last, so I told you, I'll come back to this prayer. Like we saw in the Obama clip, right? The Obama clip, that Hindu priest was praying this prayer. He was singing, Asado ma sadgamaya, tamaso ma jyotirgamaya, and mrityo ma amradankamaya. So like I said, Hinduism is on a quest. They are not giving you answer. They are raising questions. Interesting questions, profound questions, sincere questions, sincere questions. So I still remember as a kid, you know, there was a Hindu temple on one side and Christian church on the other side. And the Hindu temple, this song was Sadoma Sadgamaya and Mrithamasoma Jyotirgamaya Mrityoma Mridamgamaya. And then you will hear that on the other side, the church, there will be scripture reading. Exactly the answer to that. I am the truth, said Jesus. I am the light, said Jesus. I am the life. So Jesus said, your quest for asat, leading from asat to sat, I am the sat, I am the truth. And your quest for jyotir, I appreciate that truth, I am the jyotir. And your quest for eternal life, the amritam, I am the amritam. And that's why, I mean, it's a Hindu prayer almost directly being answered by this historical avatar who came down to this world because he was interested in humanity. So the question, if you didn't get it, is there a mention of virgin birth in the Vedas? Now, the life of Krishna and life of Jesus is being studied together a lot. And there are a lot of similarities between the life of, the birth of Krishna and the life of Krishna itself and the life of Jesus. And even the word Krishna and Christ, you know, kind of go together. And some renditions, they say, Krishna had a virgin birth and all that kind of stuff, which is exactly not how the story goes. His birth was a miraculous birth, and there was this flight because his uncle was trying to kill him. You remember Jesus' life also, Herod was trying to kill him. So there was this story, there was a lot of resemblance to the story, but I don't really think, unless in the internet. Internet you go, everybody says this. Oh, Jesus was born a virgin, Krishna was born a virgin. Yeah, internet you go, you see a lot of parallels. People just cook up everything, and especially with Hinduism, anybody can cook up anything and write. So yeah, if you are, from a scholarly perspective, if you want me to answer, there is no mention of virgin birth per se, but a miraculous birth, yes, for Krishna. Yes.
In India, seeing all the cows everywhere.
Cow is actually, first of all, Hinduism essentially is a vegetarian philosophy because they believe everything is Brahman, right? That everything is God. So when you kill an animal, animals included. So there's no speciality for human life, I mean, except in the chain of reincarnation circle. So they don't, essentially they don't believe in, they are vegetarians essentially, so they won't kill animals. But cows in particular, you will see one of the gods with the cow as his vehicle. And also cow is a symbol of nurturing and, you know, milk as a staple drink. A cow is becoming like a symbol of mother goddess in a way. So anthropologists have different ideas about that and all that, but essentially it's a symbolism of being a god, yeah. Good question, though.
You started off by saying Hinduism follows this principle of all is one,
yeah,
correct? But then in your other slide, you have a caste system, so why have a caste system?
Yeah, good question. Yeah, see, again, that's the hypocrisy of philosophy, right? It's a good question. I asked that question too. So the problem, so they will, first of all, I want you to know that the caste system comes from in the Manusmriti and all that, which is actually not part of any of the scriptures mentioned. And recently, in the 80s when I was a student, there was burning of Manusmriti publicly. So they disassociate Manusmriti from, yet it is one of the ancient scriptures. But to answer your question, they would say, just because you are in a lower caste, you are not necessarily meant to be anything lower because you do your duty. And it's like you are a doctor, you are an engineer, you flip burger at McDonald's, it doesn't really matter. You are contributing to the society. That would be one way of saying it. Another way of saying is that you have to get into all reincarnation cycle. Because you did something bad in your previous life. Your karma was bad. Because of that, you were born in the lower caste or untouchable caste in this. So it's sort of blaming the victim in the sense. It is like, yeah, you are this way. I still remember when reincarnation was taught in our university. And the professor was a Western American, not Canadian. So he was very pro reincarnation. He was teaching about reincarnation, wonderful philosophy and all that. So a Jewish woman stood up, and said, "Sir, professor, I have a question. So according to this reincarnation philosophy, which basically states that however you are born in this life is determined by your previous karma, do you think 6 million of my ancestors?" Jewish Holocaust, 6 million of my ancestors who all went to the Holocaust, do you think they were all bad people in the previous life? Pin drop silence. So it's one thing to philosophize, but, so, see, that's the problem with the Hindu philosophy, particularly. I like Hindu devotion. Hindu devotionalism is very close to Christianity, actually. Actually, some of the songs, if you sing, is kind of Christian in a way, the devotion to God, right? But philosophy is very, see, one of the problem with the Hindu philosophy is that it justifies the status quo. See, why do you think, why do you think India has such a long history, 3000 BC or something, but India has never gone and captured the world? Like India could have 1 billion Indian people, we can capture anybody except China, right? China has more people than us. But we are in a system which nurtures the status quo, which is created by the Hindu philosophy, which states that whatever way you are born, that's the way it is. And if you ask me, now I'm wearing another hat, it is created by the priestly class who wanted to maintain social order. That's why Hindus here, who are the Hindus, main popular Hindus who are here? Julia Roberts, Beatles, because they have money. They have, who are the Buddhists? Richard Gere, all these people, because they like to, they want a justification for their privilege. I know, this is a completely different, because according to reincarnation, the way you are born, if I am the teacher here, I'm the smartest guy here, because I was Mother Teresa in my previous life. I was a good guy, so don't question me. See, that was a system created by the ruling class, if you ask me. I'm sorry, but that's my response to it from a different way. So, again, your question will have no answer because it kind of reveals a hypocritical side of the philosophical system. Now, that not only in Hinduism, every religion, philosophical side has a hypocritical way of looking. Yeah, you say everything is same, but then how do you differentiate people? And caste system and class system is different. Here also there are classes, right? Rich people, you know, I mean, British society, there was class system, but you could always move up from one caste to another, class to another. You make a lot of money, you become rich, then you can move up the class. But in caste system is different because once you are stuck, then you cannot be, depends on your birth, right? So, yeah, good question, no answer. Leticia was asking why a lot of Hindus want to go to Varanasi. Varanasi is considered to be, according to the tradition, the holiest place on planet Earth, that place. And River Ganges go through that. So Hindus believe that if you are buried in River Ganges or if you take a dip in River Ganges, all our sins you have accumulated, all our bad karma, they won't call it Hindus. So don't go to a Hindu and say, Jesus died for your sin. Doesn't make any sense. There is no sin in Hinduism. Swami Vivekananda said, it's a sin to call a man a sinner. Right? Because that's not the way they understand. It's a bad karma. So the bad karma will go when you take a dip in River Ganges. So and Varanasi is the place. And Varanasi has so many temples and all that. So it's a holy ground. And they also believe it's a Kashiwas, right? Like there is gods reside there, and it's a place of Shiva. Kailas? Yeah. But it's also called Kashiwas. When people in India, a lot of people when they are old age, like past retirement, they go to something called Kashiwas, which is near Varanasi. They want to go and die there. Because if you die in Varanasi, you go straight to moksha, and you become Sachidananda, or pure bliss, pure conscience, and pure being. So that's it's mainly a tradition based on River Ganges and the city. Yeah.
I want to ask the question about the Bhavishya Purana. It's written in the Bhavishya Purana, part second, chapter 23rd.
Yeah.
I'm not going to read this hymn. It is in English. It's King Shaka asked, "May I know who you are?" With apparent joy, that male replied, "Know that I am the son of God. I am born in the womb of a virgin. Isa Masih is well-known name." How you correlate the era and the name?
That comes from where?
Bhavishya Purana.
Yeah, this is where again I have a. Let's talk about that. You know, there are a lot of. So this is the problem with the Hindu literature, right? Everybody can write up everything and it's passed on as Hindu scripture. So a Hindu will cringe at it and they'll say that's something Westerners cooked up, which almost say Jesus, right? Isha?
Yeah,
I'm not sure about that, honestly. And I don't trust a lot of Christian literature on this because, you know, I mean, with the due respect, because, you know, the Christians in their missionary zeal try to, so that's why I try not to very Christianize Hinduism, because I want to respect Hinduism as Hinduism, but I'm saying there is a mission, but there are some, like, I think it could be true too, but we don't know when it was written, and most of the Hindu scriptures was written after the birth of, like I said, some of the Ramayana and the Bhagavata were all completed 200 years after Jesus. So some of the, you know, there are Christianity in India even from AD 50s. So there was some Christian influence in writing. Also, Hindus were not particular about writing their scripture, recording their scripture. So there's a lot of Christian influence in you know. So if you go to some of this, there could be virgin birth, there could be this direct reference to Jesus, which Could be true.
One of the things that you need to understand when you're talking to a Hindu is their concept of forgiveness is rarely found in Hinduism. 20 years ago, I was doing a crusade in the city of Chandigarh. And this was the first time they allowed any public meeting, because for 17 years prior to that, there was bloodshed every day. Every day there was bloodshed for 17 years in the land of Punjab. The word Punjab, as you know, means five rivers. And they used to say there's a sixth river flowing was a river of blood because of bloodshed every day. So we had to have permission from the army and permission from the police to have a public meeting. And we were allowed to have the public meeting only for 3 hours. We held meetings for 5 days, from 5:30 to 8:30. So we had to switch off the PA system at 8:30. But we spent time, 3 to 4 hours, praying for people. There were thousands of people. Helping me was another 30 people praying for people. And it was close to midnight every night when we left the grounds. And we had army protection and police protection. So with army and police protection, thousands of people coming to hear. And one night there was a family that I saw standing there while I was praying for people. It was close to 11:30. 3 hours they stood there. And around 11:30 they came and said, "Sir, could you pray for our son who's paralyzed, waist down, because he met with an accident?" So he was seated in a car, so we went and met him, and he was doing his master's in engineering. And I talked with him for about 45 minutes, and this graduate student, he prayed the prayer and committed his life to Christ. And then his mother said something to me that I've never forgotten. It's now more than 20 years. She said, "I'm 62 years of age." Introduced me to a husband who was an engineer. Said, "I have three sons, all of them are engineers, and my youngest son is now doing his master's. He met with this accident." I said, "I've heard, and I came from a highly educated family, all engineers." He said, "I've heard all my life that there is a God who punishes sin. But this is the first time I heard there's a God who can forgive my sin." He said, "I've heard all my life there is a God who punishes sin. This is the first time I heard that there's a God who can forgive my sin." And I had the privilege of leading her and her husband to Jesus Christ. And the entire family came to the Lord, and they began to attend one of our churches in Chandigarh. This is the basic, major difference. The Hindu is longing. The quest is looking for a God who can forgive, cleanse, and give the assurance that you are cleansed, forgiven, and a child of God.